So welcome to today's webinar, Cultivating Gratitude to Support Wellbeing. So today we'll talk about the science behind the brain and well-being, how to use what we know about the brain to work for and not against us, and how to intentionally incorporate gratitude and other well-being tools into your life and our life. And I'll introduce our presenter, Anna Gray. So Anna uses her recovery from life issues to impact service systems and policy. She co-owns Pro International, which provides training, coaching, and professional development services for peers. She is co-founder and executive director of Prosumers International Recovery, Resilient, and Thriving. Anna stands for all people to have full lives. And with that, I will turn it over to Anna.
Thank you so very much, Kelly. I really appreciate it. And thank you all for logging in. So I'm hearing a little bit of an echo. I think we got it corrected. Thank you. And thank you all for logging in and saying where you're from. I could have sworn somebody who announced they were from Jersey, actually I could hear the accent when they logged in. So thank you so much for taking the time. And so I have the great opportunity to share with you all some of the learning that I've been doing around gratitude and well-being. And in the interest of time, I'm going to just jump right in. Just so you know, I am located in San Antonio. I saw several people from Texas log in. I hope I know some of you. We do have the Prosumers International here in San Antonio. We have groups also in Plano and McKinney, which is north of Dallas, in Denton, which is north of Fort Worth, in Houston, and in McAllen, which is in the Rio Grande Valley. So we cover quite a bit of Texas, and then we have a radio station that we reach internationally with that has all positive I statement type songs on it. So I encourage you, at the end you'll be able to see the website for Prosumers International. I invite you to look through it. And I also own Pro International. And at some point, if you want more information about all of those things, I'll be glad to give it to you. But I want to jump right in. So, because we are talking about a topic that we hear a lot when we start looking at things that work for peer support, and that's gratitude. So why would we even begin to talk about gratitude? Well, let's consider how our brain works and why it matters, okay? And I could do a whole, week on how the brain works. But ultimately, you could take the case that originally the brain was designed to keep us alive as an organism. That's all the especially the limbic system, the midbrain, its whole job is to make sure that we're alive. And as far as that, as it is concerned, as long as we're, we have food, water, and shelter, we're alive. We're okay. We're breathing. That's all. It doesn't care if, it's the world's most beautiful house or if it's under the bridge. It just knows you're surviving. And so ultimately, a lot of what we do automatically is designed for that kind of survival. Now, so in that sense, survival works. In most of our Western societies, we've kind of mastered the survival part. We do have a lot of people who are homeless in our country. And sad to say, the homeless in our country appear as kings to many and others. In other countries, we do have unfortunately kids who do die of malnutrition in our country, and I think that's a sad statement. But overall, we have managed to master the ability to just survive. Now, that keeps that part of our brain happy, right? It did its job. So one of the things, so survival works. There's some things that it doesn't work for, so it only works to a point. We don't actually need the following to survive, but we seem to focus a lot of time on it. We don't need to be happy to survive. Happiness actually has no survival value whatsoever. Happiness doesn't feed us, give us water, clothe us, or give us shelter. Joy joy doesn't have any survival value technically. An overall sense of well-being, and when I use well-being, I'm not talking just about our physical well-being, although a lot of it is that, but an overall sense of I'm okay, I'm enjoying my life, that has no survival value at all either. So consider the way we were originally designed as an organism wasn't designed for us to thrive. So along the way, though, we as human beings kind of messed up. We developed this thing called a cortex. And the cortex is the gray matter. It's what covers the rest of the brain. And it gives us an executive function. It gives us the ability to talk and speak in language. It gives us the ability to reason and analyze. It gives us the ability to know something's good or something's bad, or we like it or we don't like it. So somebody asked, who's my name is Anna Gray, just so those of you, I just saw what is the speaker. Actually, and somebody mentioned Maslow's hierarchy of needs. That is there too, but the actual survival part of it is just that lower rung. So as human beings, though, we developed all those other things on the hierarchy of needs that Maslow shared with us. And part of that has to do with the analytical part of our brain, which is good news and it's bad news. One is, the bad news is our automatic way of being is survival. The good news is we have a brain that can experience wonderful things, and we can train it to focus on that instead. So that's what we're going to talk about, is how do we begin to allow our brain, or focus our brain, or train our brain to work for us. Many times in its effort to survive, our brain makes choices or seems to make choices that don't give us what we want. If you've ever had the experience of really doing well, for those of us who have lived experience, realize that you actually can have a life and you can actually work and dare to reach for those dreams that you have, and you actually start taking steps for that. And sometimes you'll have the experience of literally watching yourself in slow motion mess it up. You shoot yourself in the foot, and you know you're about to shoot yourself in the foot, and for the life of you, it seems like your whole being is against you. And part of that is our automatic way of being is survival. And when we have convinced our brain that survival means being in a particular place in life, when we start moving out of that place, or we start exceeding what we thought we were capable of, that part of our brain feels threatened. So many of you have probably heard about the amygdala. And the amygdala is a little organ in our brain about the size of an almond that is, its whole responsibility is to monitor if we're okay. And that's where fight, flight, or freeze tends to originate from. And so when the amygdala begins to see that you're doing things that you haven't done in the past, it gets worried, because any change, if you're surviving and it thinks you're surviving, any change now equals mortal danger. And many times, so you could take the case that 90% of what determines our behavior, our choices, even our choice of language and what we do is controlled by 90% of our brain that we have no conscious control over. And so it will take over, and it will make choices that we don't agree with, and it will act on them, all in an effort to keep us alive. So part of retraining our brain is to convince it that thriving and change and growth are, in fact, survival. And that just being stuck and not moving and not growing is what's threatening. So training our brain is something that really makes a difference. And I am going to make a gross generalization and assumption here that most of you are either in recovery from mental health or substance use or just something that happened in life. And you have found that the way you think about yourself today is significantly different than the way you thought about yourself when you were in the middle of whatever you were going through. You can take the case, you've trained your brain to think differently. A lot of times we do it without even thinking, but what if we actually did it intentionally? And so today what I want to talk about is what would it look like when we do that intentionally? Gratitude to the rescue. There are many ways of doing it, and gratitude is one tool among many that is really great to have in our toolbox. We hear about gratitude a lot, right? And gratitude is something we tend to do automatically. I mean, most of us have had an experience of gratitude. We learn it early on. As kids, when somebody gives us something, our parents will suggest that we say thank you. Some of our parents will suggest very strongly that we say thank you. Those of us who are of a generation that still used the mail system were encouraged to write thank you notes after birthdays and after Christmas. So gratitude is something that permeates not only our general emotional continuum, it's also something that's encouraged in most societies for a lot of purposes, connection being one of them. So gratitude is something that kind of is in the air we breathe if we choose to look for it, and yet we don't always use it as a tool. So we're going to talk a little bit about what is it to use it as a tool, because it can be learned and harnessed for well-being. In harnessing it for well-being, we want to really focus on some real hands-on type stuff that we can use when we need it. And I went through all the brain and science stuff really fast. There's actually, I am going to recommend, and I put a slide in at the end of the slide deck. There is a free course online from Yale University on the science of well-being. And it's a lot more extensive than what I'm touching on here. I've used some of the material from that in this presentation, and then brought in a bunch of, you know, some other things that I've studied and looked at. But if that's something that you're interested in, that is a course online through Coursera.org, and it's free. For those of you who need CEUs, for $50 you can get a certificate and get CEUs out of it. But just if you're looking for the science behind how to live life well, it's a real eye-opener in terms of how we make choices and how many times our brain is geared towards making choices that don't always yield the result we think they're going to yield. So it's an excellent course, and I did put the information in the last slide so y'all can go and look at that. But today I'm just using a piece of that, which is gratitude and how we can use gratitude. So we have talked about in recovery circles gratitude for a very long time. I don't know that we've talked about it as powerfully as we could, because there's a sense of it being such a no-brainer and such a good idea. But one of the things that's important for us to pay attention to is that if we do not put effort into living life well, we will, in fact, survive. Our default mode is to survive. Our default way of being is to survive. So if we're out to retrain our brain, and somebody mentioned, I noticed in the chat, that they're always telling people to retrain their brain. Yes. If we're out to do that, if we really want to live amazing lives, it takes effort. Living a default life does not take effort by default. But living amazing lives, daring to dream big and to take action towards our dreams, that takes effort. It takes getting up in the morning when you don't want to get up in the morning. It takes doing that exercise when you don't want to do the exercise. It takes eating well when you don't want to eat well. It takes being with people when you don't think you want to be around people. It takes allowing yourself to be vulnerable, one of the things that scares us the most in life. So living amazing lives takes effort. We have to show up for relationships. We have to be out here where life actually happens instead of in our head all the time. So gratitude and these techniques that I'm going to cover today are an opportunity for us to begin to build that intentionality into our way of living. And gratitude is an easy step in terms of how to start and how to get going. And so that's what we're going to focus on today. And one of the things that we talk about a lot are gratitude lists. So I actually am giving you three different examples of gratitude lists in the webinar today. One of the things I do, so a disclaimer, these are techniques, these are opportunities, and these are for you to use in the way that works for you. This is not a straightforward, you got to do it this way, 1, 2, 3, and if you do it, don't do it right, you don't do it, you didn't do it right. No, this is personal medicine. This is what you do for you, and you do it the way that makes it work for you. I don't know how many of you know of personal medicine, but Pat Deegan has now created the opportunity for personal medicine coaches to be certified to really look into what is personal medicine. And I won't go into that now. I'm one of the trainers for it. But be aware. There is that. We're reclaiming the word medicine. You know, we talk about, well, that's good medicine in life. Reclaiming that word to mean that's what I do for me to feel better. It's not what I take and it's not what anybody else prescribes for me. It's what I say works for me, for me to have the life I want. So, I digress. Sorry, I do that. If y'all know me at all, you know I chase rabbits on a regular basis. But we are going to talk about three different gratitude lists, about a practice called savoring, and practice called, what I call, gratitude anchoring memories. And the savoring is also one of the techniques that's used in the Yale class. So just to make sure you know you can go there and get more information about it. All right, so I'm going to make I just thought of something I want to make sure I tell y'all at the end. I need to make a little note for myself. All right, so gratitude list. We have the usual gratitude list. Here's a possible way of creating a gratitude list. One of the things that is important, and sometimes we don't always manage to do it, is set aside the time for us to do that. I appreciate whoever said that a rabbit hole equals passion, because that so explains why I chase rabbits all the time. Once you have the time, you want to actually sit down and write down 5 things that you're grateful for. One of the ways to do that, a lot of people are like, well, I don't have anything I'm grateful for, or I'm grateful for one thing only, or we do not do this. We do not do this as a regular on a regular basis. We're not always aware of what we're grateful for. We're grateful for it in the moment, and then it goes away. So consider it initially when you start developing a new practice, it is going to take a little more effort. One way of beginning to look at what am I grateful for is to focus outside of yourself. What is there in my environment that makes my life work? What is it in my environment that makes it possible for me to even have this space to sit down and think about it in? And so a good thing to look at is focus outside of yourself. And sometimes it'll take looking back over your day and realizing that as you've gone through your day, there have been things that you have been a part of that you've been able to take advantage of or learn from, and begin to mind those for the things that you are grateful for. And whatever you're grateful for, is that's what you're grateful for. There's not a right or wrong grateful for. So be careful how much your mind, your brain, will want to pull for evaluation, judgment, and assessment. Is that the right thing? Well, that's not good enough. That's made up, so that doesn't count. Or it will try to tell you that you don't know how to do it right. Well, guess what? It's your game. You made up the rules. Therefore, you're doing it right by definition. So just continue to practice, and it will get easier and easier, and the chatter in your noggin will start settling down. So inside of that, some people say, well, what I'm grateful for is too simple. Like, I'm grateful for the air I breathe. Well, consider that without it, you would have some major distress. So that isn't that insignificant of a thing to be grateful for. It could be that you're grateful for life itself, for the fact that you got up in the morning. You don't have to look far. I collect fountain pens, and I have my collection put up, and it's one of those things that you know. You put things up and you run across them every now and then. And when I run across it, it's like, oh, I love my fountain pen collection. It's like, I'm so grateful for that. So it can be stuff that just strikes you in the moment. It can be a person in your life that helps make it work. It can be the fact that you have a place where you can do these webinars. It can be one of my favorites is I'm very grateful for coffee. In my worldview, coffee is the nectar of the gods. So find whatever you're grateful for. Again, it doesn't have to be profound. And it can impact you profoundly. And by that I mean, you can find that you're grateful for your life and get really, really present to where you are today compared to where you might have been. And it can really move you, and that's okay too. Just find what you're grateful for and write it down. And then once you have a list of five, pick one of them. Pick one of them to elaborate on. And so your list can be like the ones I listed, just little comments. You don't have to say much else about it. You know what it is. But then pick one that strikes you for that day and write a little bit about it, a paragraph or two. Why does that stand out for you as what you're grateful for that day? So continue to do that every day. Begin to develop a practice. Five things you're grateful for and elaborate on one. And you might, if you want to, after you do it each day, kind of put a little note about how you perceived your day to have been. And see if over time you don't begin to see life a little differently just because you're now taking the time to identify those things that you're grateful for in your day. All right, so another form of gratitude list. Gratitude list number two. Write a list of things you're grateful for, at least 12 things. So your initial list is long. And then every day add 3 things to the bottom of the list. And read the whole list and add 3 things. And read the whole list and add 3 things. When you will find that your list grows and that you find yourself beginning to say, yeah, I'm still grateful for all of that, but these great things also happened. When you know that you're going to have to write down 3 things every day to add to that list, one, you know what's already on it, so you're less likely to repeat stuff unless it absolutely stands out for you as something you're grateful for that day. And two, you start going through your day looking for new things to be grateful for because you know you're going to have to add them to your list. So it changes the way in which you navigate through your day because now your focus is drawn to finding the things you're grateful for. You know, some of you may have had the experience of purchasing a new car or a car that's new to you. And you think it's the greatest thing since forever because now you have transportation. And it's unique. There's not another one like it in the world. And then you get up on the highway, and all of a sudden you either see all kinds of cars that are that same color or all kinds of cars that are that same make or model. It's like, where did all these cars come from? They weren't there before I bought my car. Well, consider, your brain now says, this is something important to me, so I'm going to notice it in my environment. When you start thinking, that same phenomenon is at work. When you're like, oh, noticing things I'm grateful for is important to me, then I'm going to go look for those things in my environment. So begin to write them down and read the list. Now, the list will get long. You can read just the last 30. You know, you can start truncating it at the top and read the last 30 you put in and then add 3. But begin to really look at, take the time to look at the list so you can see how blessed you are, if you would. And I don't mean blessed as in a religious sense, but how rich you are in the things that you're grateful for. And just avoid being too repetitive with it. Again, if something stands out that's like, you know, I was really grateful for the chile relleno I ate yesterday, but the yellow curry today was even better, I can, you know, it's okay, but be careful not to fall into patterns. You want to really bring up that sense of gratitude. All right. Y'all are sharing great resources. That's awesome. Okay, so gratitude list number 3. Choose a focusing tool that has things you can count, such as prayer beads or a rosary or small series of objects that you can finger in a row. So it can be beads on a keychain. I actually have a prayer bead bracelet that I use, and it has 27 beads on it. But find something. This is a combination gratitude mindfulness exercise. It has you focus on your whatever your item is that you've chosen as a focusing tool, because you're wanting to really feel the texture of the bead of, you know, whatever it is that you've chosen to use as your focusing tool. And as you're focusing tactilely on the object, you are basically doing a mindfulness exercise. And in that state of mindfulness, you're bringing up something you're grateful for. So choose a focusing tool. Bring to mind something that you're grateful for as you focus on the texture of the focusing item. And just really feel that gratitude. Have at least 12 items. So this is something, just have enough that you really have, you really get into that state of mindfulness and focusing on gratitude. And so the last bullet point here is a challenge for those of you who are overachievers. If you are using prayer beads or a rosary, now a rosary has a lot of beads on it. Different prayer beads, if they're a necklace, have 108 beads, I believe. Prayer bracelets usually have 27 beads. Whatever it is you choose, for the overachievers, I challenge you to find something that you're grateful for every bead every day. Just for fun. But take the time, even if you do it, you know, in two or three sittings, find something for every bead. Get really focused on the bead itself so that you have that sense of mindfulness. And let yourself just bask in that gratitude. So, awesome. So those are three ways in which you can do a gratitude list that can begin to help retrain your brain. So we're going to next jump into the idea of savoring. Another way that we can practice gratitude is through savoring. And savoring, you know, when the word comes from savor, like when we eat something we really enjoy, and for those of you who are foodies, you will put something in your mouth and it's like, oh, that's so good. And within a few minutes, you're like, what's in it? What's it made of? What are the ingredients? And you try to taste, you know, what is that? Is that oregano? Or is that cilantro? Or, you know, is this made from fresh things? Or, you know, we begin to start feeling the layers and nuances of the food. So that's what we're talking about doing, but in terms of gratitude. Begin, so somebody put Stewart's orange cream soda. Yes, absolutely. Cream soda is a lost nugget of wonder for us. Ah, bienvenidos los de Yucatán. We have people from Yucatán joining us. Fantastic. Sorry, I grew up in Mexico, so I got excited. So begin to think of something. Bring up to mind something that happened during your day that had you feel grateful, that had you have that sense of gratitude. And replay that event and the experience in your mind's eye like you're watching a video. So it's okay to try to exaggerate it or put a flare on it. Do it, you know, have it live like you're producing it on Broadway. Feel all of the aspects, who was there, what they were saying, the tone of their voice, what you were feeling, how comfortable you were, what the connection was, if it is with somebody else, if you were sitting in your favorite chair, how it felt to be in a safe space. Just bring all of the experience up. Highlight the different components of the experience. Highlight, you know, where were you smiling? Were you talking? What was it like to experience the words on your tongue? Just really, really get into enjoying every aspect of that event, that experience you had. As you bring it up to in your mind that you're grateful for, and look for something you're really grateful for so that you can experience all the nuances. And even if in the middle of it, it's like, it was awesome, but I was outside and it was hot, and it was like, oh, be grateful for the sun shining. Just find a way to make it all wonderful and beautiful. And just savor it. And enjoy and appreciate it. And you can do that in 2 or 3 minutes. You can do it in 5 minutes. It's just a matter of really getting in touch with the intensity of the gratitude of all the wonderful nuances of that experience. So that's savoring. That's the opportunity to have it be really real and you know, imagine all five senses and six senses if you acknowledge the mind's eye idea, that just have it all be very real and savor every minute of it. So I'm seeing some people are having difficulty with the sound. I really apologize for that. So the next thing I want us to talk about is gratitude anchoring memories. So this is a little similar to savoring, but it is, it's about bringing up an experience in your life, and this one doesn't have to be in your day, but in your life, that is one of those experiences that had you feel fulfilled, if you would, that had you feel in the zone, like all was well with the world and with you. That you, I don't know how it may have shown up for you. It may actually have been a spiritual experience. One of the things I bring to mind when I'm using this is that, several years ago, a friend of mine invited us to go to the beach near Corpus Christi. And it wasn't really, really crowded. It was a beautiful day. And everybody was having fun doing their own thing. And I just walked out into the ocean and was just riding the waves. When a wave would come in, there were some gentle waves coming in, and I would just do a little hop to ride up over the wave and then come back down. And I kept doing that repetitively and just seeing further and further out into the horizon. And there came a point in time when it was like I lost myself. I became part of an infinite wonder. I don't know how to describe it. It was pretty, pretty amazing. And it was an overall sense of well-being. I lost myself and my worries in the awesomeness of that infinity, and just had an overall sense of well-being. So that's one of the things I bring up for me. And so you find something, and I put here, you can write it down if you want to. You don't have to, but for those of you who tend to focus easier when you write, you can do that. Get in a comfortable, relaxed position and bring to mind that kind of memory. Bring to mind that event. Bring to mind what that was like, that joy and that peace. And then just really, this is where the savoring piece comes in. Make it really real and pop for you. Bring it back into the present like it's happening right now. Just have your whole body be in the moment of what it was like when you were having that experience. And then just stay there for a while. And if it may fade a little bit, bring it back. And put yourself back in that memory like it's happening in the present moment. And enjoy every aspect of it. There may come a point, if it's a real powerful memory of fulfillment, where you lose thought. You're so immersed in the experience, it's not like you're even thinking about it. You're just it. And just let yourself stay there for a while. And as you're there, be grateful for that experience. Be grateful for that ability to be fulfilled. Bring appreciation to it. Appreciate it for the gift it is. Appreciate it for the moment it is. And really focus on the sense of gratitude of having had that kind of amazing experience. And if you do this like in a quiet place, consciously, several days in a row, give yourself time to really build this particular skill, you will find that you can bring it up in a moment when you're going through your day. So let's say you're waiting to get on a Zoom meeting. These days, I swear, we're all on webinars and virtual meetings. So let's say you're waiting to get on a virtual meeting. You only have a couple of minutes, so you can't really start something else. You've answered all your texts. Bring up that experience for a minute. Just think about it, and you'll feel it flood you, and you'll have that moment and that experience in that brief moment, and you'll find yourself feeling well, feeling filled, feeling just that joy. And as you're allowing yourself to feel it, then you can join your meeting with that present for you. And I will tell you, that meeting will go a lot better than you thought it was going to. But play with it. In the moment you have a section, like you're trying to figure out what you want to watch for TV, and as you're waiting for other people to join you, just bring it up for a minute. Just have that experience. Practice bringing it up in the moment. And there's a reason for doing that. Is when you begin to be in situations where you feel distressed or uncomfortable, and this is why I call it an anchor, you now have the habit of bringing that up. So intentionally bring that up for yourself and experience it in those moments of distress and discomfort. In those moments, being grateful for knowing that those experiences exist and you can have them again will alter how you see the distressing moment you're in. So I want to say that again. Really look for yourself intentionally. Bring up that experience that your body now, like you're conditioning yourself, right? You think, oh, my anchoring thought, and there it is. There's that feeling. I can think of that trip to Corpus, and I swear my blood pressure goes down. It's like, oh, yeah, I remember. That was awesome. I'm so glad I had that. I'm so grateful I have that moment. And I can bring that up in the middle of distress and discomfort. And it doesn't alter the circumstances, but it completely alters my ability to be in those circumstances. And to be in those circumstances in a way that's going to have me come out on the other end feeling well, feeling good about myself, and knowing that I am resilient and I am capable of living an amazing life that covers all the things that can happen to me, the deep despairs as well as the great mountaintops. So I give you this as a tool that really can begin to make a difference, especially in those, if y'all are like me going through staying at home and physical distancing, I find myself missing that contact. And so I can bring this to mind, and it will many times spur me to pick up the phone and call somebody I haven't called in a while, or have me reach out and let somebody know, hey, can you just kind of talk to me for a little while? So just, this is a powerful tool, but you got to train your brain to use it. Remember, default life, default habits. If you're out to have an amazing life and have well-being in the moments even of your deepest pain, it's important for you to live life intentionally, and it takes effort. You got to do the work. So how do we do the work? Start in little bitty bites. Those of you who know me have heard me say, how do you eat an elephant? You eat an elephant one bite at a time. Find one practice that speaks to you. Try it out for a while. It takes a good amount of time to develop new habits. But if you actually start practicing in small increments and say, okay, I'm going to do this gratitude practice for 7 days, for a full week, then at the end of the week, you can choose powerfully to do it for the next week. And the next week. Whereas if you tell your brain, I'm going to do this practice for the rest of my life, it's going to say, no, you're not. No, you're not. That's too much effort. But you can do it for today. You can do it for 3 days. You can do it for 7 days. And just begin to build the habit to the point where not doing it seems weird. You are now training your brain to focus on those things that are going to have you see amazing opportunities in your life that have been there all the time. You just can't see them because that's not what your brain's focusing on. So just begin to allow yourself to practice a bit at a time. All right, so I didn't put my name here. I guess I could have. So my name is Anna Gray. This is my email. And I put both of our websites up for you. And you also have on the last slide, and we're not done. I just want to leave time for some questions. But I do want to make sure that you know that you have these slides will be made available on the MHA webinar website, as well as the webinar, and you will be able to maybe look into the Coursera course. There were several other recommendations that were made in the chat if you wanted to look at those as well. Yes, I am from Texas. Well, I was born in Texas. I grew up in Mexico. I was 14 months old when I left Texas, went to Costa Rica for a year, and then was in Mexico. Lived in Saltillo, Coahuila for 7 years, and then Mexico City until I came to college when I was 19. So I miss Mexico, just in case. But I definitely am a Texan, and now currently live in San Antonio. So any questions? Anything I may have missed, Kelly, because I wasn't keeping up with all the chat?
You didn't miss much. I'm just saying everybody was putting in all of these descriptions of nature, and I'm so relaxed just reading everything that everyone was sharing. But it looks like some questions are coming in now. Someone asked if you could go back to the slide with your information on it.
Sure.
And then someone, D, asked, could you review the brain?
Yes. Okay. So somebody also said that I wrote down something I didn't want to forget. And mm-hmm. So what it was to remind y'all that you do this in small bites. You don't have to tackle the universe at once. So thank you. Thank you for making sure I remembered. Mm-hmm. So the brain. Our brain. So when you look at how our brain is constructed, you know that it's made of neurons. And up until recently, if you were studying, you know, science in high school, you were told that we were born with 100 billion brain cells, and that's all the brain cells we would ever have the rest of our life. At one point, I was taking a linguistics course, and I was told that our brain keeps growing until the age of 40, and after 40, we actually our brain stops growing, and we start losing brain cells, but that we have so many, we can afford to lose them. All of that, and that was in graduate school, so that was the science of the time. Well, guess what? The more we learn about the brain, the more we have no clue how this thing works and why it works so well. So what we have figured out, though, is that it isn't true that we don't create new brain cells. We've also found that there's a type of cell in the brain that everybody thought was really not that important. They're cells that are called glial cells. And those cells were, at the time, they just thought it was, you know, what cushioned the neurons and the matrix the neurons function in. What they're now finding is that the glial cells are essential in the health of the brain because it helps process waste matter and get it out of the way of our brain's functioning, which is also why sleep is so important, because all of that happens while we sleep. So when you're not sleeping, your brain's not getting its daily cleanings, which is not a good thing. And so, yes, I train in Spanish. I just saw that. So couple of things about, so I say all of that to say we're learning so much about the brain, but one of the things that we have found is that We know that the neurons tend to communicate dendrite to dendrite. So on the end of each cell, there's these little finger-like things called dendrites, and they connect through the synaptic gap. So when you talk about neurotransmitters, the neurotransmitters are chemicals that get in the synaptic gap that make the neurons work. Well, we thought that you just had, you know, the end of one neuron to one other neuron, and that's how they connected. What we're finding now is that generally, or at least what they think, is that generally each dendrite, especially in the gray matter, tends to have 100 different nodes on it, and they can connect at any point of those nodes. So in essence, we have as many connections in our brain. So let me ask y'all, think about your favorite beach. Now, do you want to count every single grain of sand on that beach? Probably not. Well, so if you would take the case that each grain of sand is made up of several different molecules of silicon, what they're now determining is we have as many possible connections in our brain as there are molecules in the universe. That's a number we can't even fathom. So when we're retraining our brain, what we're doing is we're reassigning connections. We're changing connections. And so we're finding that instead of trying to do away with bad habits, if you create new ones, you're reassigning those neurons. So it's easier to stop doing what you don't want to do by doing something that you do want to do. So when you look at that, we can retrain the brain in amazing ways. There's a lot of science on this. I noticed in the chat when we were when I was talking about it, about traumatic brain injury and the importance of brain training for people with traumatic brain injury, we're also finding that the brain, we thought that parts of the brain were fixed and they couldn't be taught to do different things, and we're now finding that isn't true. So just begin to be aware that our brain is an amazing thing and that we have not even begun to scratch the surface on what's possible. And those of us who are in the recovery community are uniquely placed to play with, experiment, enjoy all of what the brain can do, because we've shown that it changes over time. Because today we can be on webinars. There was a time in my life I couldn't get out of bed. I mean, like literally I felt paralyzed. So if I'm up and talking to you guys today, something happened, something changed. So we can have amazing, amazing opportunities to retrain our brain. So that's a little more about the brain. There's a lot more that you can talk about. The way they found out about the glial cells is just kind of an interesting trivia. When Einstein passed away, people put in a bid to get a piece of his brain to study. And seven different scientists were given that opportunity. And what they found was his brain was like everybody else's, except that it had more glial cells than anybody else. And that was a shock to their system because they thought glial cells didn't do anything. So sometimes we find out stuff by accident and find things that we never thought we wanted to know. So just begin to get the power of self-exploration and knowing that there is no such thing as being realistic because we have no clue what we're capable of. There were times in our lives we didn't think we'd be capable of, you know, being worried whether or not we could connect the sound on a computer. So consider, we don't know what we're capable of. And we don't know what our minds are capable of and our brains are capable of. So go live amazing dreams. All right, so any other, I'm used to having really interactive training, so I'm like, are y'all out there? Anything else? Any other questions that come up? I haven't kept up with all the...
Yeah, there have been a bunch of questions. Let me go back really quickly. See. Oh, there's so many thank yous coming in. It keeps bringing the chat down for me. Let's see. One question. So why not repetition on the things you're grateful for? A lot of things I'm grateful for are constant in my life, my wife, my health, my friends, my activities, etc.
So there is a phenomena called hedonic adaptation. And what that does is, have y'all ever thought, you know, you were so excited because you knew if you got this one thing, you were going to be happy. And guess what? You got your one thing, and you were happy for 2 days. And then you went back to wherever you were before you got your one thing. So hedonic adaptation is that we will have that sense of pleasure, but then we go back to a plateau, to a you know, just business as usual. And so when you do the repetition, it tends to trigger that adaptation to where it's like, yeah, I'm happy for my life. I'm grateful for my life. I'm grateful for my life. Now, if you're generating it newly each time, then absolutely you can do it. But be careful, because sometimes that repetition kicks in the adaptation and we're not having the true, the deepening of that gratitude experience. Besides that, it also limits what you look for in your environment, because then you know what you already have and you stop looking for the new things. It's not that you can't repeat it ever. Just be careful that you don't repeat the same things over and over again every day. So I see a comment here that some people have difficulty accessing their imagination and can't do cognitive work. So absolutely, there are different learning styles, different capacities. For folks like that, it's a matter of finding something that will work. Sometimes being able to write. And by writing it down, I mean putting pen to paper or pencil to paper, not necessarily writing words, but drawing what you're grateful for, drawing the, and it can be symbolic. It doesn't have to be that you're an artist and you make it look exactly, but that you know what that is, so you have a visual cue. For those who can't always imagine it, if you retrace your steps during the day, like right now, most of us tend to be at home, so or we're the only one in the office. Just think, where did I start my day? At the front door. So walk, you know, or at the bedroom. Walk around your house and look for visual cues of things that may have happened during your day that you enjoyed. That you were grateful for, that you enjoyed and were grateful for. So find what works for you. If you know that that is a challenge for you, mark them down as you experience them, and then go back and just look at the list. Obviously, it really helps the richer your imagination is. But if you have difficulty with that, find, you know, do the list technique. Do something else that really works with your learning style and your ability to create recall. There's also a resource that just got put in terms of accessing our imagination. Our imagination is something that some of us weren't encouraged to use a lot, and we can develop the skill. Well, I actually knew a counselor who worked a lot with people in terms of visualization. And one of the things that he would do for people who said they couldn't visualize is that he would have them describe their refrigerator, what color it was, where it was in the house, what was in it, what side the handle was on. And what he would help them begin to see is that in order to tell him that information, they actually were visualizing it. And they hadn't put two and two together that our memories have a visual component to it. In fact, that's one of the things that they recently was a discovery, because our vision is controlled by our occipital lobe, which is the back of our brain, and they didn't think it had anything to do with memory. And what they're finding is that there's constant communication between the hippocampus and the amygdala, which is where a lot of memory happens, and the back of the brain. And I'll go on forever, so I just realized that we might be a little over time. Sorry.
No, this has been awesome. Everybody, we got a lot of comments and questions still coming in, so I wanted to just say thank you. This has been a really phenomenal presentation. And for folks who are on, thank you all for attending. Thank you so much, Anna. This has been really great. As you all can see, the information to contact Anna and to check out some of the different things that she's working on and involved in is up on the slide now. But otherwise, as I mentioned, the webinar was recorded. So early next week, you will get an email with the webinar recording and the slides. And they will also be available on MHA's webinar page on our website. And then next week, our two webinars next week, one will be focused on community health workers, and then the other will be focused on youth engagement. So stay tuned for those announcements and to sign up for those too. Thank you all who've been logging onto our webinars, and thank you. Really grateful to you, Anna, and to everybody for joining today and for your comments. And I hope you all have a really wonderful rest of your day and rest of your weekend.